approximately 35 minutes. And in these 35 minutes, what I'm trying to create is to give you some opportunity to talk about something which might be bothering you since morning and you could not find answer to your query. It could be a topic on itself. It could be a topic or a point or a question which came because of some talk. So that's the idea. The process would be, since we have a feedback and we talk about it, was the session objective clear? So I want to make the session objective very clear so you don't rate me bad there. So session objective is to give people an opportunity to talk about something which is bothering them. Second, give a participant an opportunity to answer or to put their learning related to that topic. So I am just a facilitator, I may add sometime the points, but that's the goal. But along with that, the third objective is we also need to respect the time. So we can't go beyond 5:30. So these are the three goals I am catering to. So the process is simple. We will make our backlog, and then we will do a prioritization of the topics, and then we will pick up as per the priority till 5:30. So I will start collecting the topics now. What is bothering you? What do you want to talk about?
This feedback form shouldn't be ambiguous.
Like, okay.
What is one, what is five?
That's a conference feedback. So that is something I can give now, that's an answer. Five means good, where one means not that good. Okay. So five is towards positive and one is towards negative. And if you keep watching Twitter, you would have known by now, because you would have known that how we are putting up, we are trying to put real-time feedbacks. We are not using app, and we thought that using app may not bring that much participation, so it's a manual process, but we are doing it on a real-time basis. So five is good. Okay, back. So what topic do you want to discuss? Transformation of middle management. So how do we transform the middle management? That's the one topic. And what factors plays a role in transformation of middle management?
Not only middle management, we have talked about the cultural changes in each and every topics we had. Right?
True. So we can have a mic also here and there, please. Because this is an audience time, so we should have maximum mic in audience.
So how do we do that cultural change across the organization? So which includes each and every level, starting from our bottom to
So what I'm hearing is how to bring a cultural change in an organization.
Yes.
Is this the point you want to discuss? Okay, bringing cultural change in an organization. Kelly, are you hearing me? Bringing cultural change in an organization.
When we are talking about this, we should be more practical, not over
the theory. True. Not about a theory that we will have a CEO kind of approach by every manager, every employee.
Because since from the morning, what we are more hearing the theory of ideal
world.
It should be ideal. It should be ideal. But how to implement that? Because we know when we are going to implement the Agile in any organization,
how practically implement Agile? Is this the topic you are talking about?
Practical at the lower level, we know. But at the higher level,
probably what we are looking at is three magic lines to make sure that when we recommend that implementation of Agile, the doors don't shut out of place. Shut on the pacing, that's the way we are. So three magic lines probably, or three magic words to probably take it forward.
So what I'm meaning is that you want to have some elevator statement, pitch statement, which you use that as a template, and then says, wow, is that your thing?
at least we get another 10 minutes of attention.
Okay, let's put the topic. Let me see that putting topic doesn't mean we will discuss that.
Why do organizations give up on their agile journey?
Okay, so why the organization give us on their agile journey?
Yes.
The fourth topic. The third topic is a magic line, magic punchline to make manager buy agile story. Elevated statement. Okay, and the why organization give up agile.
How organizations will bring as in a continuous improvement in all sprint ceremonies?
Okay, how do we improve continuously?
Continuous improvement. In all ceremonies.
How do we improve agile practices? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, improving agile practices.
Matrixes
on Agile. You didn't hear the color clock today, Mahal? Yeah, you should not be using matrixes. Okay, good.
So the other thing
In addition to the cultural question here, how to sustain cultural change? We're talking about servant leadership and all these things, and suddenly things go.
So how to sustain the dynamic environment?
How to sustain the change? You started making transition.
Okay.
Bringing few
how do you keep the momentum away? Momentum
how to sustain the change that you've made right now? Because at point in time,
true. But the point I think we'll discuss it when we get into it. So maybe there's a subtopic.
Aligning same mind with Ajay.
Okay, too specific. Yeah. Okay, aligning same mind with Ajay. See my institute guys who moved around Bangalore, Chennai and some area for last one week. I see a lot of teachers and QA was sharing a lot of photographs. 18 and few weeks. So I think they are exploring Indian market again because nowadays they are not making that much money they used to make. So they are worried.
So we are talking about the agile transformation adoption, but then how do you know that it's working correctly?
Okay, so how do you measure success in agile? How do you measure success of agile adoption? Success in agile and agile leadership, I think two people need to write now. Anyway.
HR practices to retain developers, because in agile there is more dependency on the developers, but developers keep shifting.
Okay, how do you reduce attrition in Agile? Final one more, and then we'll go to prioritization.
Cross-functionality.
Cross-functionality
is not accepted so much in the team.
Okay, great. You also tell?
So Agile transformation in the system organization level. How Agile coaches help in the system level? Only not in the Agile part, but system organization level, as mentioned by HR.
So
we
will get into
Agile
transformation.
Agile and organization.
So it's just a sub.
Agile and organization.
Cross-functionality. So isn't the cross-functionality important? Okay, I'll be. Then we will go tomorrow, we will do more things. And if we like this stuff, we can have maybe something more tomorrow. Okay, so now it's a difficult thing to do. We need to have some voting. Okay, so the
right number.
Okay, so we need to have voting where there could be an error, so don't be so absolute. Okay, there could be accounting errors. But basically, we are looking for a trend, so don't start fighting, okay, we were one more vote and all those stuff. So let's have a generic voting. So let's talk about agile transformation. How many of you, how many votes do you want to give to agile transformation related topic? Cultural change, transformation, everything goes there. I think this is the first topic, let's go into it. We don't have to count. So agile transformation, so let's put everything there. Cultural change, organization structure, and maybe cross-functional team. So these three things can come into agile transformation. Okay, and elevator pitch as well. So let's clock. Yeah. Agile transformation, cultural change, cross-functional team, and during this discussion, somebody may give an elevator statement for handling this thing. Okay, I'm sure this will take more than 20 minutes, though we can still talk about next. Now, why organization give up agile? Improving agile practices, CMI, measuring success. So measuring success and why organization give up agile, I am clubbing them together. How many of you want to discuss measuring success in agile, failures of agile?
One more thing.
Yeah.
One statement for the managers to sell agile.
So because somebody guide us during the agile transformation. Okay, best we will see. We don't plan the complete sprint. If we lack this time, then we will pick up, okay? Let's follow Kanban, not Scrum. So pick up the one item and finish it, and then talk about the next item. Okay, great. Agile transformation? Let's start about it. Okay. Who in this group, how many of you are working with organizations and helping them or facing an agile transformation on their own? A real game, not from the side, people who are in the game. Okay, so there are people who are in the game. In this group, now second question, do you have a statement to make, an elevated statement to make, which reflects your learning till now towards agile transformation? So anybody can share one, it should not be more than 2-3 lines, but just talks about defines agile transformation, how it is working. What's rock? Give to Deepak.
The way I have seen organizations adopt agile, it is mostly towards a goal or a cause that is not agile itself. Most organizations have a need for improvement, could be penetrating to newer markets, could be increase our market shares, could be increase productivity, throughput, output, outcome, whatever it is. It is this goal that drives them, and they use agility as a means to reach this goal. This is what I have seen of my agile transformation.
Great. Anybody else want to add? So I am just trying to rephrase what Deepak has said. A movement, a goal towards more value is something which is helping, which is making companies think towards transformation. What else? Okay, let's move next. So what hinders the agile transformation the most? Where do you get stuck? When you want to move agile, so it means the organization has decided to move agile. It's not that development team starting thinking about it. Somebody at the top started thinking about it. Then where do we block? Yeah.
Mostly the block comes the organization itself, the current way of how the organization is put. And what I have also seen in the transformation in our company, the senior management commitments are there, but somehow middle management commitments are not yet seen there. So they can buy in from the top that we should all go, but they all have a fear in terms of how it will be impacting us, because there's a lot of change you're bringing on.
Great. So message get disformed when it starts from top to bottom, and the middle management is the one which creates the maximum confusion. There is something your experience is saying. Yeah.
Well, of course, old habits are one thing, and the second thing is that the management expects that process changes should happen without affecting deliveries. So okay, the timeline for the deliveries and costs remains as it previously was. And the team is expected to innovate into the new cycle as well as deliver as it did before at the same time, which is really not feasible.
Great. So what she's saying is that even we want to change, but we want to keep current deliveries going as it is, and we want to transform, but without compromising on the current delivery, which creates stress in transformation. I think somebody was talking there.
We are talking about the agile transformation, and we have basically, I have seen in the current organization where they are planning to transform to agile methodology. But when you talk about the agile in the organization, it's not coming from the top down. It's actually coming from the middle management, where the scrum or the sprint going on. So there is no commitment from the top management, but they want the commitment from the middle management and the resources.
Okay, so in your experience, the agile transformation activity which is going on in your organization,
yes,
primarily driven by the middle guys.
Correct.
And not by the top guys.
That's not supported. Yeah. It's not supported by the top guys.
Supported, yes. Not supported by the top. Okay, great. Yeah, come here and let's take a few more views.
Organization point of view, the rewards and recognition process is very demotivating for the employees, and the middle managers are making their best to nominate the people from their team, but somehow not everybody gets rewarded, and the middle managers are not able to explain why everybody is not rewarded. That is one thing. And at the team level, self-organizing with the cross-functional team is a challenge, because in the current sprint, developers and testers are mainly focusing on the deliverables of the current sprint, and they are not coordinating with the BA and UX team to finalize the upcoming requirements which are there in the backlog. So when the sprint planning meeting happens, it comes to as a surprise to the dev and test team, and a lot of changes are getting done in the user story at that point of time.
Great. So what I'm hearing is that we are trying to process the ceremonies, product, work items or artifacts of Agile and Scrum, but in the process the message is not coming, the feeling, that morning thing, being Agile, doing Agile. So the being Agile is not coming and we are trying to doing Agile. So that's the one of the thing. But again, let's remain on the practical stuff. So we hear something here, there's a lot of theory. Let's talk about something practice. Okay, so we can say, oh, be Agile. So what be Agile? What do I do tomorrow? I know be Agile, but what I should do differently tomorrow to become Agile? Yes, sir.
So I think what kind of thing I'm facing daily is like the fear in the team.
Okay.
As we say, that fail fast, but that is not what the culture has imbibed in them. They were always succeeding in something, but they do not want to fail now. And the same way the managers, like somebody said, middle managers, they are looking at them and saying that you will succeed. If you fail, we are going to wrap it up in the first sprint itself. That fear, I think, that is coming up.
Okay, so fear for failure, early success needed. So you had a chance, Neha. We give it here. And then finally, one more to Deepak, and then I will try to conclude from there. Yeah, I give it here first. You have only one mic.
There are multiple points here.
Yeah.
Whenever it's the transformation really happens, so it's always come from the top. So that's the most successful one, basically. But whenever it happens, you always do in a pilot mode. And that one of the questions you ask about why usually Agile fails or a company give up. So they choose a pilot team, basically. They choose a pilot team and they say, well, let's go to start working with Agile now. And that when pilot is going to happen, they provide everything in their plate. So they are kind of spoon fed. So infrastructure is for them, they have team readiness, cross-functional team. Everything is given to them so that they become successful. But rather than top management understand, the team becomes successful, Agile is successful right now. So let's start. But rather than understanding basically why they become successful, because everything is given to them in plate. So a larger organization, when it's going to happen, so infrastructure is not ready, teams are working in silos, the different departments are working in silos, they are not interacting with each other at this point, and when they're going to transform, give to the organization at a whole, they fail. They won't understand this. Because everything is given to them.
Great. So final call. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, I think the roles are getting mixed up a lot. The Scrum Master behaves like a project manager, he like daily stand-ups become a daily status meetings and all that stuff happens, and product owner is not given the full authority to take decisions, he's acting like a business analyst. So there's a mix up of roles and there's not clear definition, which is why I feel Agile fails.
And the transformation also fails. How many of you follow Scrum? Okay, if you all follow Scrum. So we were talking, how many of you play cricket? Okay, now which stadium you go for playing cricket? Maybe in your balcony? Yeah, so that is what, everybody follows Scrum. Now which Scrum you follow? No, I follow in balcony, not here. So that's sometimes the issue is, and this can become more and more clear when we look at a Scrum and a survey also. When you look at the survey, you will realize that 90% of the so-called Scrum is not the Scrum of the stadium one, it's the balcony one, it's the street one, but still a Scrum. So, yes.
Lack of
implementation. Yeah, so I would like to put something concluding, just final call, and maybe we don't have a perfect answer, but let's see. Yeah.
So, I think where it fails, we all know that it comes from top. Sometimes we say it's coming from middle management. But I think transformation is a journey, it's not the destination. And I believe it's a mindset. Basically, if we have that mindset right from the top, from bottom, I think it will success. But then what we try to do in the transformation is putting the old wine in the new bottle. And that's where the transformation kind of like starts with that mindset. If you look at the success stories of some new startups and all, they are all successful. Why? Because it's not a transformation, it's kind of like they have picked up and they are following us.
So they don't have a baggage.
Yeah.
So that's a problem sometimes comes. So I'm just trying to conclude with some summaries. You may agree, disagree, we can discuss them on Twitter continuously. First let's talk about cultural change. Many people have been talking about cultural change. How many of you have looked at surveys which talks about agile failure modes? The version 1, Rally, all these tool companies conduct these kind of surveys every year. And I have been monitoring them for 2-3 years. And the first reason of failure in agile and scrum adaptation comes from culture was not supported. And it is such a difficult thing to define culture and to make a supportive culture, but it's easy to blame culture was not supported. So like earlier, something goes wrong, what happened? God did it. Now what we can do? Yeah? So everything was act of God earlier. Gradually we started understanding science, chemistry, then say, still whatever we don't understand is act of God, but rest of the things we start thinking. And that is what happens when we don't understand anything, culture change. Culture is the one which happened and did it. So I had an interview with somebody, a person named Ahmed Siddiqui. He runs IC Agile thing, and he talks a lot about agile mindset and all. He made a good metaphor to make culture visualization. He says culture can be visualized as a rubber band of many things, on top of many things. Now people who read MBAs and all those stuff, they talk about skills, structures, systems, leaders. These all put together defines culture. So we can say that what is your leader's belief system? This is something, one dimension to a culture. What kind of skills do you have in your organizations? Development skills, testing skills, risk-taking skills. Then you may have a process what is your development process? Then you have an organizational structure. Now you may have a lot of organizations where timesheets are mandatory. You may have a various organizations where you, if you don't follow the exact in time and out time, your leaves get rejected. Now they can't change this policy just because you are an agile team. They run a big organization. I was talking to one of the guy, he worked for a German company, he used to come in our meetup. He was saying that we have an insurance policy, if we stay more than X amount of hours in a week, our insurance becomes invalid. So organization, because we follow the same policy which is followed for the workers. So there could be things which is coming from the structure. And this all things put together makes culture. The appraisal system, the type of recruitment process you have. Now, a good agile company, they take 15 rounds of interview, they take 6 months before they hiring people. And you have a different organization who hires 15 people in an hour. Now, how can you match the same thing? Yeah, we talk about we need to have a such type of people in Agile where team is given to you. You are a Scrum Master and this is your team. Okay, you need to have self-organization. You don't have say in doing that. So everything put together makes the culture. And when we just try to change the process, we are changing this. So earlier there was a waterfall. Now we have a Agile. So we push the process. Now when we push the process, things will go down, not up. And that is where the problem comes in. People are saying everything will be good. Now think of, you want to reduce your weight and you want to reduce your intake of sugar or you want to reduce smoking. What will happen? If you stop smoking, your life will be miserable for some time. You will say, what the hell I am going through? This is a bad thing I am doing. You will eat again. So any change will bring you down. And that is where the technically people talk about something called curve. J-curve. So that is a simple thing, and you know people like good crazy words. So it's a J-curve which represents that you are happy here, you are healthy here, though a bit healthy, but you are healthy here, you can do your office work. And you start doing dieting, you go here. You know you hardly can work for 2 hours in a day because you are going through a dieting. And you will say, what the mess I am in. So your performance from waterfall to agile is like this only. Yeah, and then gradually it will take some time before you reach here and start producing. And many times, this is where the strain is. It requires a lot of push because you have not reached here. And if in between this cross push goes down, you come back. How many of we end up leaving the diet plan? How many of us leave the idea of leaving the smoking? We come back. So if we don't make a sustainable new set of rhythm, a structure, process, skill, leadership into a new pyramid, it requires an external force. External force of a CEO, external force of a coach or someone. And if this coach goes out, you will be back here. And we keep talking about change, transformation and all. Change management is a big industry. If you see weight loss, it's a big industry than agile, you know. I am thinking of becoming a weight loss trainer than agile trainer. It can help me earn more money. And the concept is same, you know. There I am just trying to change an individual. Here we are trying to change a bigger people. So change is always difficult. So don't think that it is easy. And it is also said that you should not be trying to change someone. The more you try to change, it resists. And you say, no, I will remain like this only. So it is easier to create a new habit. It's not good to abuse waterfall, but talk about a new habit. He says you keep doing whatever you are doing, but let's do differently. So you still keep remembering what you were doing before, but you have a new way of doing things. So that could be the way which we can, in our limited exposure, but we should be aware. Now, when we say practical thing, these are practical things, you may not have a control on it. Now, we can talk about culture change, without culture change, nothing will come. You may not be, as a Scrum Master, may be able to deliver that change. But also look at a different dimension. In the same organization, you may have 6 Scrum teams. Few of the Scrum teams would be doing better than your team. In the same organization structure, in the same organization policy, similar type of resources. Let's focus on a positive psychology or a sweet spot. What is working for them? And in that practical sense, you can pick up something from them. If you read a book, it will tell you a theory which was good for one company. But if you look around in your organization, you can find some ways to repeat the success which is happening inside your organization. Maybe, and a lot of depend upon leadership of the team, of a Scrum Masters, and something may be working here. So that is a practical takeaway which you can take. Yeah, it's a big thing that you, most of us are not at a level of changing an organization. Maybe we will reach there someday. But as of now, for a team level, we can just start visualizing that why things are working, why things are not working, and what we can do at that level. Middle management does play a role in a cross-functional team. Now, there is a big debate about cross-functional team as well. Why should we need a cross-functional team? And the debate is between Scrum and Kanban. So you, the people who follow this Scrum versus Kanban might be seeing this, that Kanban does not believe in cross-functional team. And David Anderson keeps saying that it's a wishful thinking to think that everybody will work in a one group. Now, again, it depends upon the context. If you are having a small project and you have a one UI team, it makes sense to keep a UI team as an independent and give a work to from a different project rather than putting a UI guy to each team. Similarly, there could be a scenario where there are 2-3 enhancements going on the same product line, and the testing may want to remain integrated at a one place, so the skill set remains at a one place, and they may have some isolated testing in there, and it may make sense for you in some context even not to have a cross-functional team. So we can't just follow a one recipe. Maybe it add value, maybe it is not economic in that particular case. Final thing, elevated statement for making a manager or something, I think it's difficult. So I end up into a situation where I was giving a training to people, and you know, the corporate training, this kind of situation only comes in corporate training. So I asked them, what do you want to achieve in these 2 days? I was expecting a lot of expectation will come. The guy looked at the watch and says, just finish the training by 4:30. That is what we are expecting. Okay, so that was the only expectation they were having. Okay, great. So now it was a very resistive batch. Then the approach I used is that the world is moving towards agile. If you guys will not learn, you will not get jobs somewhere else. Okay, and even if you don't focus on this, your organization may wake up tomorrow and they see inefficiency won't survive for long. Like if you are finding that everything is, many of us has worked in a company where there was lot of luxuries, you know, Yahoo and all these things, you take leaves and you do whatever you want and good amount of salary getting, but many of them could not survive. So if you don't have a proper efficient organization, you are at risk, you are not at a good place, because someday somewhere will wake up and say what these guys are doing. So in order to, like Jeff Sutherland keeps saying, change or die. So in today's environment, if you are not agile, you are not professional anymore, a working professional anymore. There's a huge crisis at the middle management level to sustain their jobs. Okay, and we will find, and it's already there, people are more unemployed in that segment, and or they say not properly employed. They might be doing a less valued job than they could have done it. There is no promotion, there is no growth, even sustenance is difficult. So if you want to sustain, you need to be with word. Else, the way Nokia died, you will also die. So individual is also same, you know, because if we want to make money, we need to at least keep adapting to the market. If you want to make more money, then our adaptation speed should be faster than the market speed. So our learning should be faster than the market, and that is how the company grows. They learn faster than the market, they grow. The company which keeps learning as per the market, they survive. The company which remains back, they die. So change your diet. So that could be your elevated statement. So I think we can move on. Make some sense? So we had a conversation towards elevated statement, cross-functional team, cultural changes, and middle management. Okay? So good. We still have 5 minutes. And let's talk about measuring success in Agile. So I was looking at a Scrum Alliance survey 2015 one. So there was one most dissatisfied like user answer was coming that we don't know how to measure success. That was the most confusing thought from the people who responded for Scrum Alliance survey. So it is a real problem. It's not your problem. We don't know how to measure success, and this is not a new problem also. When we were in project management, so I trained people in project management. It's not only Agile, we talk about PMP and all those stuff. During those days also, measuring success is always a problem. Sometimes we measure by time, sometimes we measure by success, sometimes we try to measure by the value it delivers. So, and it's very good to talk about that we should focus on value delivery, but many times it becomes very difficult to convert that. So the only thing is, identify your own measurements. And the J curve which you looks like this. I think agile frameworks are also going through this J curve, and they are also getting mature. Like day before, last week we were having session on sale, and we were talking. Most of the agile framework starts from product backlog, okay? And they assume that you know what, and they start from the market research. But most of the IT company starts project from where? Contract, pre-sales, fixed risk, time material, okay. Now from where the agile project starts? There is no project charter, there is no pre-sales, there is no contract. So they start from somewhere a product thing. So they, many of them does not address the need which we might be facing in our day-to-day real life. And our measurement of success may vary based on the type of contract you live. Many times discussing contract becomes a very controversial topic, but do you think that you can isolate a contract which you have with a client from the development methodology you are using?
Yes, we are doing that.
So isolating or integrating?
Time and material or both, which is a mix of fixed fee and T&M. And we will have another point called methodology.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So which methodology is it? Is it agile or waterfall or some kind of a mix of that?
So you have a project life cycle selection model.
Yes.
So what I am hearing is you are not isolating. What you are doing is based on contract type, you go through some questioning, the maturity model, team model, I think the CGI speaker was talking about, and you identify which framework works well.
Yes, actually we take a mix of some steps from waterfall and some steps from agile, and we also put some phase gates which are like milestones.
Now somebody will say this is not agile, but this is something makes sense
for the customer.
If you are going through a type of contract where you need to really work there. So anything which we learn through, anything which we go through, will have some external parameter which need to be adapted. We can't put a same story everywhere. And so the contract will play a role. Measuring success should be defined as per the contract, as per the customer, as per your boundary. Scrum team primarily assumes that end users are giving you a requirement and you are deploying to the end users primarily. In between, product owner is there, but the complete team is handling end-to-end cycle. That is the primary assumption it starts with. But in many real case scenario, which is real in Indian context, maybe different in different world, this is not the case. You have a two layers here, you may have a two layers there. And something happens in between and you are just part of the game. You have a different definition of done, which is not the customer deployable definition of done. So it varies, and same question comes with the metrics also. So we need to figure out which life cycle works best for us and pick up accordingly. That's it. So any question on the second topic? So we achieve the time box. And yeah, not necessarily question. Thought sharing also, yeah, because I started speaking in the second. Anybody want to share 2 minutes? We have 3 minutes time to talk about measuring success in agile. What is working, what is not working in the case?
See, when we're talking about a success, typically it is identified based on IT and non-IT. Now, even in non-IT, we have a very structured way of executing activities, process defined. And what I attended today, one session was embedded at system programming, system software. Agile implementation. So it actually looks like 5 years later, honestly, because we don't have a roadmap, we don't have a guideline. How do you approach such segment where you know they are so structured as in punch in and punch out, and then suddenly you tell them, even if you suggest a small section which may not be mission critical,
true.
Suggest agile implementation. So it's like, you know, putting your, sticking your, that's what I asked you, the punchline, to stick your leg into the door so that door doesn't shut on your face. And then, you know, take it forward. So I guess non-IT organizations, to bring agile, you really need to figure a pathway across.
True. And the point is, as a coach, we can't become an idealistic, or as a professional project manager, program manager, you can't just put a theory in front of them. You need to speak a business language. So we should collaborate with stakeholders and define success. And a success which can be understood by both of us and we can agree to. And none of the methodology stops you doing it. Nobody gives you a process of defining it purposefully, else you will become too bound to a one level only. So it's not like that Ken Schober and Jeff Sutherland could not think of these problems. They could definitely think of all these problems, but they don't want to prescribe anything there. They want to keep those areas light, so you figure out what works for you. And they only want to prescribe the minimum thing which needed for to make the development work. So that's why it is kept open.
So it's about the business agility basically.
Yeah,
true. People are don't talk about using, so they think like, okay, well, keep agile and agile transformation is happening. But think about the whole business perspective. So my friends, keep in mind, nothing comes, nothing goes without finance. Okay, so whatever you do is always connected to the finance.
Yeah.
But there's no company working in charity. Everyone wants to increase their revenue. So whether agile, non-agile, any problem happens, they always management come and say, I want delivery to happen. To help you agile. Become agile. I've faced this many times. Okay. So the thing is, how can as a team, as a program team or as a big team help our business leader to achieve what they are trying to achieve? So in terms of the revenue, in terms of the values. So people talk about the value they take. Value in terms of what? So well, everything, so whether you DevOps, whether you take it agile, is always connected to business. I'd say business, DevOps, SAC, compliance, whatever you can call it, start DevOps. Okay.
I agree with you on that. Delivery is a must, okay, no doubt about it. But at the end of the day, that is the reason why the measure of success needs to be put.
So that's what I'm coming to this.
Various things, otherwise, delivery team will be, or the development team, or the test team will be held accountable and say,
how are you going to measure that?
Yeah.
So when you're going to define your vision, basically. So the vision is basically
comes from the team. Everyone are made responsible in their own areas, and the measure of success is defined for each one of them.
Well, you're going to come, basically, you define your vision. So vision is at a strategic level, it's going to happen. It's going to further work down to the team and the epic plan, then do maybe a user stories or features of feature and all. So at each level, there are going to be definition of the condition of satisfaction. And then those are going to be different from your team. Your team level definition of that is going to be different. Operational satisfaction is going to be different.
What we're looking at ballpark is we're looking at various stakeholders and the benefits at various levels. So that it's positioned in totality, so that it's accepted in totality.
True.
And there is no one who's going to stop so as a team. So when, as keep on thinking, when a Scrum Master is working with a Scrum team, over a period of time, the team becomes self-organized, self-managed, self-empowered. You expect, or organization expects the Scrum Master should go and move out. So self-organized team should not have a Scrum Master. That's my own thinking.
We are making people afraid here, so don't talk about that.
But in that scenario, basically, the thing is we need to work with the product owner as a consultant and give our own suggestions to the product, so how it's going to be evolved and give more benefit of it.
Great,
that is a very good point, but eventually what it happens at the end of the day is what we do. What I mean, my observation is people, like Chandan mentioned it very well today, he said tomorrow what role you're playing might not exist. Change or die. So probably I believe the mindset, if you have the army with you and whatever technology comes in, maybe you want to take up some other framework or methodology, so that mindset you have to build, that will be success for you.
Right? It's a good video on talk about the attitude. If you have a right attitude, you can...
Great. So I think we are on the same page. All the three participants of the interaction, the four interactions were in the more or less in the same alignment. And we can talk about course that you can ignore economics, but economics will not ignore you. If you don't have a money, you can't buy food, you can't go to a medical doctor, whatever good work you do. Okay, so similarly, the organizations also have to live in that area. And just final word, we need to be very clear a difference between success criteria and acceptance criteria. Many times, this is another confusion comes in at a team level. Acceptance criteria could be at a feature level, user story level, you know this does this. But the success criteria is more about business oriented. So it is like you want to have a phone, mobile app which can help you to do a carpooling. Okay. So the success criteria is you want to serve 10 million users per day. That's a success criteria, and that is for which the project has been started. Now it doesn't talk about features. You may change 10 directions towards the feature, but you achieve that success criteria. And at the project level, there is always a success criteria. Sometimes we don't inquire about it. Sometimes we don't care about it, we only care about acceptance criteria. The more and more we inquire about success criteria, I think the measurement of success will be more and more clear to us. So that could be a practical takeaway we can take, that okay, I will ask in my team, what is our success criteria? And how do I see, and I change my language when I negotiate with my product owners, with my stakeholders, to drop some features, to change some timelines, to achieve that success criteria. Great friends, thank you for the full day of participation, and tomorrow we are starting on time. to be here. 9 o'clock sharp we will start, and we have lots of talk, two keynote talks, and again tracks and manual today. Thank you, and keep tweeting. You can tweet your feedbacks, questions, and suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.